I also have the honor and privilege of endorsing, supporting, and introducing the person who will be the next governor of the state of Vermont, David Zuckerman, the current lieutenant governor of Vermont.
Thanks for the endorsement.
Well, I guess I ought to let y'all know I'm endorsing Andrew as well for governor of New Hampshire. It is really an honor to be here right across the river from my home state, because I'm here to tell you a little story. I was one of those many people, part of that 90 million people right now who don't normally vote in presidential elections or don't really care about the big political establishment and the system. I was active on a lot of social issues, environmental issues, economic justice issues, but I thought the political system was not where the solutions were gonna come from. And frankly, that's still true. It's gonna come from right here. It's gonna come up from the people, right? Right? And there I was at UVM, an activist student, studying sometimes as well, and I saw this amazing congressman. This guy who came up and said, I don't take corporate donations. I'm standing up for working class people. Higher education has to be more affordable and accessible for all. Healthcare is a human right. Our climate and our environment is suffering. He was saying those things back in 1992. And I looked at him and I said, wait a minute. He's in office? He's in Congress? How is this possible? This is so exciting. And I volunteered at UVM, and we registered over 1,000 students to vote that year to get him reelected to Congress. And through that, I met people just like you. I was a young person, student, just like some folks in this room. And we were part of the movement in Vermont. And just a year or two later, some folks asked me to run. I lost in 1994 by 59 votes. But folks rallied. And 2 years later, I got elected, and now I still pinch myself. 25 years later, I'm Lieutenant Governor of Vermont. That's coming up from the bottom, from the inspiration of Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders is why I'm Lieutenant Governor. Not because he happened to endorse me over and over again, but because involved. And that's what's happening in Vermont, in New Hampshire, in Iowa, in South Carolina, in Nevada. Day in and day out. Now, the pundit class will say, well, it's all about the middle. There's these 1 million magical voters. And if we just toggle them this way or that way, that's how we're going to win. They forget that there's 90 million people that have been disenfranchised by this system. And sure, Bernie's going to get some of those middle people. But the way Bernie's going to win is bringing in millions and millions of people. How many people have heard some statistics about young people coming out to vote for Bernie? Have you heard those statistics? Right? How many people have heard statistics about struggling working class people coming on the Bernie team? Have you heard about that? How many people have heard the whole language, Bernie's too angry? Bernie's too angry! Well, guess what?
A lot of people are anxious and scared and angry because they are working their tails off 40, no, 50, no, 60 hours a week. And they are still living paycheck to paycheck, struggling to just keep a roof over their head, feed their children, put fuel in the heat and fuel in their car, and they're nervous that the next week or the next month, they may not be able to make ends meet. They're angry. We're angry. Because in a society of this economic magnitude, it is completely immoral that half of our country are living paycheck to paycheck, while the billionaires are getting away with economic murder. Right? Well enough off that, Bernie's going to go a little too far. I make $300,000, $500,000, $1 million, $2 million a year, and I can't pay $5,000 more in taxes. Or we can be out there saying, this is a movement and a wave and a revolution of our political system that says, everybody in. When we talk about working together and everybody in, some folks say, we need to bring the Democratic Party together. Or we need to bring the country together when they're talking about some independent voters and some Republican voters. Bernie's saying, everybody in. Let's bring those 90 million people into the system and into our democracy, because democracy is about people. We got to bring people into our democracy, not money in our democracy. That's what Bernie's all about. So I just got the last couple questions for you, and then I'm going to introduce our next speaker. I saw Bernie's speech in New York. I wasn't there, but we all saw it over and over when AOC endorsed him. And he was talking about your neighbor, and the person over there, and the woman over there, and the person down in Louisiana, and everywhere else. We're in this for everybody else. We're not in it for ourselves. Everybody in this room is here because you care about yourself, your family, your friends, your community, and people that you don't even know. Because you have true patriotism and support and love for your brothers and sisters and non-binary friends all across this country, and frankly, around the world. You care about koala bears who are starving in Australia because of the climate crisis burning their woods, as well as all the people in Australia, of course, who are struggling and suffering. That's why we're here, because it's not about us. So, I have a question for you. Over the next 2 days, are you ready to talk to your friends and your neighbors and anybody who you see in the grocery store and at the gas station and make sure that they're gonna vote on Tuesday? Are you ready to do that? Yeah. Are you ready to talk to your family and make sure they're gonna vote on Tuesday? Are you ready? Yeah. Are you ready to talk to your neighbor and get them out to vote on Tuesday? Are you ready? Yeah. Are you ready to get out there and vote for your community on Tuesday? Yeah. Are you ready? Are you ready to vote for everybody in this room, everybody in this state, and everybody in this country? Because the vote turnout in New Hampshire and how it is interpreted in those hours, preferably not days like the last one, in the hours after the results come in, are going to shape the future of this country and the world. This day coming up is the most important day in our history, because when Bernie wins and the momentum builds, there is no stopping what's possible. And that's what I'm asking you about. Are you going to be a part of that future? So, I have had the distinct pleasure and honor to speak with our next speaker at a couple different events. She rocks the house. She is an inspiration for all of us. She has been working her tail off for Bernie in the last election, every day in between this election. It is an incredible honor and pleasure to introduce Senator Anita Turner.
I just want to thank you all for coming out in this cold. As I was saying to folks in Keene and where we've been traveling all over this state, that for those of you who've gone out to knock doors, it's one thing to knock doors when the weather is pleasant. It is another thing to knock doors when it's minus 4 degrees. So thank you, baby. I'm cold. Jackson, our incredible state director, and the entire team, New Hampshire, that just yesterday alone, that volunteers from this state and volunteers from other states who came in to give folks from New Hampshire a helping hand, that yesterday you guys knocked on 150,000 doors. Come on. It's all on you. Just in case you didn't know.
That's right.
The eyes of the world are looking at you. Not too heavy, though. Just all on you. And speaking about something being all on you, only all that we love is on the line. People in the White House who doesn't kowtow to high money interests, that does not hold fundraisers and wine caves with Swarovski crystals. Hello, somebody. Somebody who doesn't make excuses about how they should raise money. The incredible Dr. Maya Angelou once said that if you know better, you got to do better. We know better. We understand. And Senator Bernard Sanders has paved the way. No more excuses. You don't have to raise money like that anymore, because he tried and tested it out in 2016, and we're doing it again in 2020. Hello, somebody. See, his only special interest are people like you in this room and people just like you all over this country. He only has the answer to you. Now, I just want to take you down memory lane, if I might, just for a minute. In 1930s, President FDR stood up against the special money interests and the elites of his day, and they hated him. And he said in a speech that I welcome your hatred. And we fast forward to 2020, and we have Senator Bernard Sanders pushing an agenda that is similar. So if I can just, in 1944, FDR called for an economic bill of rights. You students of history might remember this. And what was encapsulated in that 1944 bill of rights? The right to a job, the right to a living wage, a right to affordable housing, a right to quality education, a right to secure retirement, a right to decent health care. Hello, somebody. A right. He said what people are entitled to, not what they might, should, or could have had, but what you are entitled to. That was FDR in 1944. Fast forward. And Senator Bernie Sanders, the same thing, economic bill of rights for the 21st century. And we added some things to that. Bail reform. Hello, somebody. Legalizing marijuana. Hello, somebody. Reforming a legal justice system that somehow sees black men. Hello, somebody, who get gunned down in their homes. Black women. Somehow it's more criminal than somebody else. We've added to that economic bill of rights because the senator understands that the biggest existential threat to this nation and the world is climate chaos. Hello, somebody. Are we adding to it? Humane and just immigration reform, we adding to it. And then, if I might, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Now, we just celebrated his birthday. Sisters and brothers in New Hampshire, y'all all know we in Black History Month. Hello, somebody. Can a sister get some love for that? Now, Black history is 365. It is America's history. It is bigger than MLK Day. It is bigger than the month of February. But let me just, the reason why I'm pulling out the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is because he was a democratic socialist. And he critiqued this nation and its greed. And before he was gunned down, he formed the Poor People's Movement, of which Reverend William Barber of North Carolina is carrying that on. But it was a movement of white people, black people, brown people, gay people, straight people, religious people, non-religious people.
And what they had in common was that they were poor. And fighting against a system that was rigged against them in the 21st century, in the year of 2020, we find ourselves right back there. So what does that mean, Sister Turner? I'm glad that you asked. It means that in Senator Sanders, we have, to quote the great Dr. Cornel West, a long-distance runner for justice. We have somebody that is willing to carry on the legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and all of his contemporaries. Let me shout out Fannie Lou Hamer. Let me shout out Ella Baker. Hello, somebody. Let me shout out Barbara Jordan. Let me shout out Shirley Chisholm. Come on, somebody. That's what this movement is about. We don't have time to play games with it. So this is it, New Hampshire. Either you are on the side of the people or you are not. Either you believe that morally the people of this great nation deserve health care that is really care, because what we have now is a health system that doesn't care, or you don't. Either you believe that we should transform from K through 12 to pre-K to college and trade school, or you don't. Either you understand that the biggest existential threat to this nation, and dare I say the world, is climate chaos, or you don't. Either you believe that we need to reform a legal system that is unjust in every stretch of the imagination, or you don't. Either you believe that we need to build a multicultural, racial, ethnic, and gendered movement, or you don't. Either you are willing to stand up for the people, or you're not. And we can't play games with it. So this is our question to folks running for office, especially those people running for president of the United States of America. Whose side are you on, baby? You can't have fundraisers in wine caves with Swarovski crystals and talk about the billionaire class and get more money from billionaires and still claim that you're on the side of the people. Whose side are you on? Mayor Bloomberg, you can't buy the office and skip Iowa and skip New Hampshire and then decide that somehow you're going to come in during Super Tuesday while you skip all of these other states and then give money to the DNC so you can buy your way up on the debate stage. Whose side are you on? Whose side are you on? Now, we are tired of bailing out Wall Street. But then when it comes to putting just a little down payment on Main Street, people talk about what we cannot afford to do. Let me tell you what we cannot afford to do. We cannot afford to continue to bear the brunt under the weight of immorality when it comes to greed in this nation, of Wall Street, of the pharmaceutical industry, of the fossil fuel industry. That's what we cannot afford. Who's sad? I'm asking you, whose side are you on? And what we know, New Hampshire, about Senator Bernard Sanders is that he's on the side of the people. And we got the receipts, hashtag roll the tape. We know who he is. In the Christian tradition, the question is called, you will know the tree, or a statement is made, you will know the tree by the fruit that it bears. Senator Bernie Sanders has been bearing good fruit for a very long time. And what we can be assured of, New Hampshire, is that when our senator gets to the White House, he's not going to sell you out. What you can be assured is that he tells the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help us God, and he doesn't bend to the will of the elites in this country. Whose side are you on? It's time to pick a side, baby. Pick a side. Whose side are you on? And so while we got talking heads waxing poetic about a class warfare, hell, the elites have already declared war on the working poor and barely middle class in this country. And so if we are going to duke this thing out, it's time that the working class people in this country win. Whose side are you on? Hello, somebody. That's what I'm talking about. In in this movement. And when he wins, he's still gonna need you. I don't know if they told you that now that you're in, you can't get out. Because the senator's mantra, not me, us, means something. That he understands that once he becomes the 46th president of the United States of America, that Wall Street is not just going to bend to his will. The fossil fuel industry is not going to say, you know what, President Sanders, you were so right, we so wrong. He's going to need a movement of people to push that Congress and to push the people in this nation to understand that it's time to stand on the side of the working poor and barely middle class. I want to see mamas and daddies be able to look into the eyes of their babies and say, baby, you can go to college or you can go to trade school, and it doesn't matter how much money I make or do not make. Hello, somebody. I want to see reform in the criminal justice system, injustice system. Hello, somebody. Oh, my God, I'm doing this. But we know what side Senator Bernard Sanders is on. But we're going to call the question on these folks over and over and over again. Waxing poetic and saying a whole lot of words and ain't really talking about much of anything. Whose side are you on? So, sisters and brothers, can y'all do something for us, sister? I'm feeling good. I don't know if you can tell. I haven't had a lick of coffee today, but I'm feeling good. So you guys know I do this all over. Whose side are you on? Two quotes, and then I need you to do something for me, as I'm going to bring up somebody who's near and dear to the senator's heart. But I've just been feeling some kind of way for a very long time. And it is time. This is our time. We're never going to get a moment quite like this again. This is our time. And New Hampshire, you're going to shock and awe. You're going to let folks know whose side, who stands up on the side of the people, all people from all walks of life. Two people. One is Congresswoman Barbara Jordan. She said these words: what the people want is simple. They want an America as good as its promise. That is really what this fight is for. That's what Medicare for All for. It's for college for all, canceling student debt. It's creating an America as good as its promise. And we got the money. Don't let them tell you we don't have the money. What we don't have is the will. And number two, Sister Helen Keller. I don't know, I've just been feeling her, and I'm starting to research her, and she was a radical to her bones. And she said this. She said, alone, we can do very little. New Hampshire, I want you to follow me, but together we can do so much. Alone, we can do very little, but together we can do so much. We are together on this. And don't let these people scare you and talk about how we can. Oh, no, we're going to change the dynamics in this country because we're all going to do this together. So, whose side are you on? It's time to pick a side. All right. Now, can you raise one hand for yourself and one hand for somebody else? The great Dr. Maya Angelou once said, have the courage to stand up for yourself. Hello, somebody, this audience participation. And courage to stand up for somebody else. Have the courage to stand up for yourself and the courage to stand up for somebody else. With these hands, we will have Medicare for all. With these hands, we will have college for all. With these hands, we will cancel student debt. With these hands, we will cancel medical debt. With these hands, we will have transcendence. And with these hands, we will elect Senator Bernard Sanders, the 46th president of the United States of America. Hello, somebody. Oh, no, we're going to do this. All right. It is my distinct honor and pleasure. Everybody feeling warm? You feeling good? Okay, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce someone who is near and dear to the senator's heart, who knows him far better than any of us, who has been with him all of his life. I bring to you Levy Sanders.
Wow, thank you guys so much. Nina, you are extraordinary. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Today is our time. It is for now. We have an ability to have a Medicare for all, single-payer healthcare system that guarantees healthcare to every man, woman, and child without out-of-pocket expenses. It is our time to have tuition-free public colleges and universities with no college or university debt. It is our time right now to have paid equity for women. Women right now, on average, get 79 cents to the dollar. They deserve the whole dollar. It is time to have paid family and medical leave. We need on average 47% of folks are living. And we will take on the fossil fuel industry. There are so many other issues that we need to take on. And with your help, we will achieve this. But now, give a warm welcome to the next President of the United States, Bernard Sanders.
Claremont, thank you. Thank you, Claremont. You met my son. Let me introduce you to my wife, the next First Lady of the United States. To my daughter, Karina. To my grandson, Cole. And my granddaughter, Tessie. Thank you. Let me thank all of you for coming out today as we begin the election cycle for the most consequential election in the modern history of America, an election which will determine in many ways the very future of our country and what we stand for as a people. Let me thank those who have spoken already. Let me thank Andrew Walensky, the next governor of the state of New Hampshire. Let me thank David Zuckerman, Lieutenant Governor of the state of Vermont. Let me thank Senator Nina Turner. See, one of the banes of my existence is I always follow Nina all over the country. And after I speak, people shrug their shoulders, oh, boring, you know. But Senator Turner has not only been a great force on our campaign, she's been running all over the country doing the most important work that can be done, and that is involving people in the political process. So Senator Turner, thank you very much. And let me thank my son Levy for his fine remarks, which means I don't have to say anything because he caught my whole speech. So. And Adrian, too. Where's Adrian? All right. Thank you, Adrian. You're right. All right. Let me start off by telling you our campaign is off to a very strong start. As I think most of you know, in Iowa, we won the popular vote by 6,000 votes. Not too bad with 8 people on the ballot. And we won the realignment vote by 2,500 votes, not bad. And let me say a word of thanks to the people of New Hampshire, not only for the support you gave me in 2016, but more important than that. As some of you may recall, when I came to New Hampshire in 2016, I had an agenda, and you heard it from Nina Turner, you heard it from Levy Sanders, of what we were fighting for. And 4 years ago, when we talked about that agenda, an agenda for the working families of this country, We were told by the political establishment, we were told by the corporate establishment, we were told by the media establishment that those ideas were too radical, too extreme. Nobody would accept it. Well, the people of New Hampshire did. Thank you very much. And what that meant, you see, as we live in a strange world where you have big money interests defining for us what is legitimate, what is practical, what is real, what we can accomplish. And I think of the great Nelson Mandela, one of the great heroes of my lifetime, who said, "Everything is impossible until it happens." Everything is impossible until it happens. Well, New Hampshire, you helped make it happen. As a result of your vote here, 21 other states also voted for our agenda, and that agenda is unfolding all over the country. So when I came here and I talked about a $15 an hour minimum wage, people said, "Oh my God, you want to double the federal minimum? Can't be done. It's completely crazy." Seven states have passed $15 an hour minimum wage. And the United States House of Representatives has passed my legislation, $15 an hour. So and it goes on down the line. The issue that we face is not only opposition from the corporate world, from the political establishment, from the corporate media. The opposition that we face is something that we have got to break through ourselves. It is the limitations of our own imagination. So what our campaign is about is essentially asking, why not? Why not? This is the wealthiest country in the history of the world. Should we have half of our people living paycheck to paycheck? I don't think so. Should we raise the minimum wage to a living wage of at least 15 bucks an hour? Yeah. Should we continue a situation where women in America are making 80 cents on the dollar, or do we have equal pay for equal work? Yeah. Do we make it easier for workers to join unions? All over this country right now, there are millions. All over this country, there are millions of workers who want to join a union, but they face illegal opposition from their employers. Workers get fired when they try to organize. Well, we have a proposal in that we will implement when we are in the White House, which will double union membership in this country in a 4-year time. When we talk about the needs of working families, we have got to talk about education. And again, I ask you to take a step back, think outside of the box. You're living in the richest country in the history of the world. Every psychologist in the world will tell you that 0 through 4 are the most important years of human development, emotionally and intellectually. All right? Everybody knows that. So if you love your country, which we do, if you love the children, which we do, why is it that we have a dysfunctional child care system in which working families cannot find quality, affordable child care? There's no reason for that. It is simply a question of priorities, where the people who run our government think it is more important to give tax breaks to billionaires than have universal, quality, affordable childcare. We are going to change the priorities of this country. We're going to protect the children and the working families. And when we talk about education, I want you to just, again, take a step back. Go beyond what Congress talks about. Go beyond the talking pundits on television. And understand that in your state, right here, in this great state of New Hampshire, a couple of months ago, I talked to some educators, and they said, "Bernie, there are some school districts right here in New Hampshire that start teachers off, new teachers, at salaries of less than $29,000 a year. So here we are talking about the future of America being our kids, understanding that in a competitive global economy, it is imperative that the kids get the quality education that they need. And the logic suggests that to do that, we need the best and the brightest to become teachers. That we want young people in college all over America saying, you know what, I am so proud. I am going to become a teacher and do the enormously important work of educating future generations. Nothing more important than that. So in a country where we can give baseball players hundreds of millions of dollars in their contracts, you know what we can do? We can pay teachers in America at least $60,000 a year. And when we talk about education, what I want is these kids right here. And I want kids throughout this state and throughout Vermont, throughout America, to understand that if you do your schoolwork well, you're going to do your schoolwork well? All right. That regardless of the income of your family, you will be able to get a higher education. That's not a radical idea. No? You know, 100 years ago or so, very brave and courageous working class people said, you know what? We don't want our kids to be working in the factories or working on the farms. We want our kids to go to school. We want our kids to get a free public education. And they fought for that and they achieved it. So we have free public education from K through 12. That's good. The world has changed, all right? Technology has changed. The global economy has changed. And for these kids to make it into the middle class, in most cases, they're going to need a higher education. So we have got to redefine what public education means, and that means making public colleges and universities tuition free. Anybody here think that this is a radical idea? No. It is not. And it, in fact, amazingly enough, it not only exists in countries all over the world, used to exist 50 years ago in this country. We had the great public universities, University of the City of New York, University of California, virtually tuition free. If we could do it 50 years ago, if they could do it all over the world, we could do it here in the United States. And I'll tell you something else that we're going to do. How many folks here are dealing with student debt? Please raise your hand. Well, here's what. When you think outside of the box, seeing the crime that you all committed, the reason you have your debt is you said, you know, it is important that I get a higher education. Wow, what a terrible idea. And you're being punished for that for decades. Meanwhile, 11 years ago, the crooks on Wall Street, whose illegal behavior nearly destroyed this economy, hey, they got a huge bailout, no problem. All right, they are the leaders. Okay, 2 years ago, Trump and his friends gave $1 trillion in tax breaks to the top 1% and large corporations so that Amazon last year made $11 billion in profits, owned by the wealthiest guy in America. You know how much taxes they paid last year?
Zero.
So it just occurs to me that if we could bail out crooks on Wall Street, if we can give the richest guy in the world his company not paying a nickel in federal taxes, we can cancel all student debt in America. And we do that through a modest tax on Wall Street speculation. We bailed out Wall Street. It is their turn to bail out working families. Now, I want you to, again, step outside of the box, forget what the media talks about, forget what Congress talks about, and ask yourself a very simple question. Every human being needs health care. That's a fact. We all need health care. So I want you to think again, think. How does it happen that we are the only major country on earth? We are the richest country on earth, but we're the only major country that doesn't guarantee health care to all people as a human right. How does it happen? How does it happen that we end up spending twice as much per person on health care as the people of Canada and most European countries? How does it happen that despite spending twice as much, $11,000 for every man, woman, and child, we find that 87 million Americans are uninsured or underinsured? 30,000 people die each year, 30,000, because they don't get to a doctor on time because they don't have health insurance. We pay by far the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs, and 500,000 Americans go bankrupt because of medically related debt, i.e., they came down and are fighting with cancer or heart disease or Alzheimer's. It is not a radical idea to say that in America, if you have cancer or heart disease, you should not go bankrupt. And we have got to understand that the American people do understand healthcare is a human right, not a privilege. It doesn't matter if you are rich or middle class or poor. When you get sick, you should be able to go to the doctor and not worry about the cost. If, God forbid, you have a serious illness and you go to the hospital, you should be able to leave the hospital without some huge debt hanging over you for the rest of your life. I have been all over the country talking to people, and people have $1,000 a month premiums. They have $1,500 a month in premiums. The average worker in this country makes about $60,000 a year. That family makes $60,000. That family pays $12,000 a year for health care, 20% of their income. That is outrageous. That is unacceptable. Meanwhile, while our people are paying by far the highest prices in the world for health care, last year the healthcare industry made $100 billion in profit. So I say to the healthcare industry that the function of healthcare in a rational and humane system is to guarantee health care to all, not to make the drug companies and the insurance companies filthy rich. And I want to say a word on the pharmaceutical industry. You know, there's always a debate in my office of which particular entity is the most corrupt and greedy, whether it is Wall Street or the pharmaceutical industry. Not quite sure, but I tend to think that the pharmaceutical industry is even worse than Wall Street, and I'll tell you why. It is not just that they charge us, in some cases, 10 times more for the same exact medicine sold in Canada. About a half a year ago, I took a trip from Detroit to Windsor, Ontario, with a number of diabetics. Anybody here dealing with diabetes? No, okay. And we found, we went to Canada to buy the same exact product sold in the United States, insulin, same company. Who wants to tell me what the differential in price between insulin in Canada and insulin in the United States? Anybody know it? Yeah, 10 times, that's right. So we went there with people, working class people, and we were able to buy insulin for 1/10 of the price same product, same company as in the United States. Now, why is that? Because in this country, the drug companies own the United States Congress. Go to the internet and you find out that pharma, or whatever their front groups is, makes enormous contributions to Democrats, Republicans, everybody. They're all over the place. In fact, in the last 20 years, they have spent $4 billion on lobbying and campaign contributions. They have the leaders of the Republican Party, former leaders of the Republican Party, former leaders of the Democratic Party, you name it. They have bought the entire Congress. And their purchase, when you buy the Congress, the result is you can raise your prices to any level you want. So you've been taking a medicine for 20 years, you walk into the pharmacy tomorrow, and you say, I want to fill my prescription, and the guy says, well, I'm sorry, it's now double what you paid yesterday. Perfectly legal, they can do it. There are no laws to prevent them from charging any price they can get away with. And not only that, I'll tell you something else, and I say this more than aware of the terrible, terrible suffering that New Hampshire has experienced because of the opioid epidemic. We have had a serious problem in Vermont. You have had a much worse problem. And this is how bad the situation is. When the opioid manufacturers, companies like Purdue and Johnson & Johnson, learned and knew definitively that the product that they were selling was addictive and was killing people, you know what they did? They hired more salesmen. Well, and thousands of people all over this country died. They are now being sued, as many of you know, by attorneys general all over the country for many, many billions of dollars. But we've got to go further. And we have got to ask ourselves, what does it mean that CEOs who knew the product that they were selling was killing people continue to sell it? That is a criminal offense, and they must be held accountable. Now, the insurance companies may not like it, and the drug companies may not like it. But we are going to expand Medicare to cover every man, woman, and child in this country through a Medicare for All single-payer program. And that means that all Americans will be able to go to any doctor they want, be able to go to any hospital that they want. There will no longer be any premiums, no more premiums for you or your employer, no more out-of-pocket expenses, no more deductibles, the absurd concept of a deductible. We will substantially lower the cost of prescription drugs. Okay? And we will end the absurdity of Americans paying double what the people of any other country pay for health care. And when you pass a Medicare for All, I want you to just think for a moment, because we don't talk about this, you don't hear this on TV. What does it mean? What does it mean to the stress level in America when you know if you or your family are sick, somebody goes to the doctor, that's it. You don't have to worry about whether you can pay it or not. And I'll tell you something else. There are millions of people in America are now staying at jobs they do not like. You know why they're staying at those jobs? Because they have decent coverage. Now think about what it means when everybody in this room and everybody in America has the opportunity to do whatever they want. You go to the job you want. Maybe you want to start a small business. Whatever you may want to do. Maybe you get fired. If you get fired, you still have health care. All right? Healthcare is there for you. You don't have to stay on a job. I don't want to relate all of the horror stories that I have heard here in New Hampshire and Iowa, all over this country. But one comes to my mind. It was a woman, young woman, I would say in her 30s, and she had a job. She had health insurance. She was diagnosed with cancer. She lost her job. She couldn't go to work. She lost her job. She went in for cancer treatment. Couldn't afford it. She had to skip treatment. All right. That is what is happening in America. When you have health care for all, doesn't matter whether you're working, not working, doesn't matter if you want to change your job, doesn't matter if you want to start a small business, doesn't matter if you're 2 years old or 102, you have health care as a human right. It is there for you. Medicare today is a strong program. It is a popular program. We are going to make it better as we expand it. What does that mean? Today, Medicare does not cover dental care. Last that I heard, dental care, oral health, was part of health care. We're going to cover it. There are a lot of people in this country, especially senior citizens, who can't afford the outrageously high cost of hearing aids. We're going to cover hearing aids. We're going to cover the cost of eyeglasses, and I'll tell you what else we're going to cover, which is enormously important. All across this country, elderly people, people with severe disabilities, are kind of forced out of their homes to go to nursing homes when they would rather stay home. Medicare for all will cover home health care. And we pay for this in a number of ways, but one way we do it is we're going to stop the profiteering of the healthcare industry. We're going to stop $500 billion in administrative waste because the system is now trying to administer thousands of different health insurance plans. And that costs a fortune. Hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars wasted just on administration. And I'm sure your family, as well as my family, has been on the phone time and again with the insurance companies arguing about whether you're covered or you're not covered, right? All right, we are paying for it. You're paying for the guy at the other end of the phone to tell you that you're not covered when you thought you paid for it. All right, that's all gone. What we do is put money into doctors and nurses and healthcare professionals, not into bureaucrats telling us. When we talk about the needs of the American people, we have a president today who is doing such a disservice, not only to the people of our country, but to the world, when he claims that climate change is a hoax, when he exacerbates the problem by encouraging the production of more fossil fuel. So let me tell Trump what he should have learned a long time ago. That what the scientists are telling us is not just that climate change is real, not just that it is caused by human activity, not just that it is already causing devastating problems around the world, but that the problem is far more severe than they had previously thought. That the polar ice caps are melting at a faster rate, that the oceans are warming. That the level of drought that we are seeing is more severe than had been anticipated. Turn on the TV, look at what is happening in Australia today. That beautiful country is burning before our eyes. Take a look at what happened in California and the unprecedented level of terrible, terrible fires. That is the future of the world unless we get our act together. Take a look a few months ago at what happened in Venice, Italy, which was underwater because of torrential rain. Same thing happened in Houston, Texas. Expect more and more severe weather disturbances. What happened to Puerto Rico? What happened at Hurricane Sandy? And other terrible disasters. Expect more of that. Expect as the ocean becomes more acidic, that it'll be harder and harder for people around the world to eat the fish that they need to get the protein they need to stay alive. The United Nations tells us that if we don't get our act together and the planet keeps warming, by the end of this century, there could be hundreds of millions of climate refugees. You know what a climate refugee is? That's somebody who can no longer stay in their community because there's no water to drink and there's no land to grow their crops. And if millions of people migrate from one country to another, you're going to have huge amounts of international tension and growing wars. What the scientists are now telling us is that climate change is an existential threat to our planet. And if we love our kids, and if we love our grandchildren and future generations, we must have the courage to tell the fossil fuel industry that their short-term profits are not more important than the future of this planet. And that is why I am proud to tell you, I'm proud to tell you that we have introduced the most comprehensive climate change proposal based on the principles of the Green New Deal that has ever been introduced by any candidate for federal office. And what the Green New Deal will do is create up to 20 million good-paying union jobs as we transform our energy system away from fossil fuel to energy efficiency and sustainable energy. And when we talk about the needs of working families, let me say a word about the needs of our veterans. I am the former chair of the U.S. Senate Committee on Veterans Affairs, and I am proud to have introduced the most sweeping veterans, pro-veterans legislation in the modern history of this country. And I'm proud, and I'm very proud that we have received the highest awards. I've received the highest awards from the American Legion and the VFW, because when people put their lives on the line to defend this country, they deserve, without any question, the highest quality health care we can provide to anybody, and to get the benefits that they deserve in a timely manner. That's what our administration will do. And I'm proud to have worked with your New Hampshire senators in making sure that the VA hospital in White River is one of the best in the country. And when we talk about the needs of the American people, it is imperative that we bring about fundamental reforms, and Senator Turner talked about this, about a broken and racist criminal justice system. I don't want to be the president of a country that has more people in jail, disproportionately African American, Latino, Native American, than any other country on earth. We have got to invest in our young people, in jobs and education, not more jails and incarceration. We have got to end private prisons and detention centers. We have got to end the so-called war on drugs and legalize marijuana in every state in this country. And when we talk about systems that are broken, instead of demonizing, attacking the undocumented in this country, we need this country to move toward comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship. Under our administration, federal agents will not be snatching babies from the arms of their mothers and throwing children into cages. And on day one, we will reestablish the legal status for the 1.8 million young people eligible for the DACA program. Now, every American, regardless of his or her political views, whether you're conservative, progressive, whatever you are, is appalled, is sickened by the kind of gun violence we see in this country. And it is one of those issues where people just shake their head. They say, I can't believe it. It is so disgusting to me, I don't want to describe. You all know what happens. But that we have a nation that is not effectively addressing this crisis And the reason for that is one reason. The American people want strong gun safety legislation. There are differences of opinion, I know that. Rural states like New Hampshire and Vermont, you know, but in urban areas, but there is a coming together of the American people, whether it's urban or rural, whether it's gun owners or non-gun owners, to understand that we have got to address this terrible crisis. I remember I was here in this state a few months ago, I'll never forget this, and a woman stands up and she says, Bernie, what am I supposed to tell my 11-year-old daughter who wants me to buy her a bulletproof backpack for Christmas? And what that means is, in this state, I know that because I have grandchildren in this state and in my state, you have all these emergency drills. All right? What a horror that is. To have kids who go to school, they're supposed to go to school to learn, to socialize, and they're sitting around worried about something terrible happening. All right, so my promise to you is that our gun policy proposals will be written by the American people, not the NRA. And, you know, while there are differences of opinion, how do we go forward? There are differences of opinion, but there is a broad consensus out there of the following. People understand that we need universal background checks. You have a violent past, you were involved in domestic violence, well, you know what? Sorry, you're not gonna get a gun, all right? We are gonna end the so-called gun show loophole and the straw man provision, which allows people to legally buy guns and then sell them to criminal elements. And there's something else that's gone on in recent years. This is something kind of new, so although I've supported it for decades, is after seeing some of these terrible, terrible shootings, the American people have concluded that we must eliminate the sale and distribution of assault weapons in this country. I am a United States Senator, and I'm on the Senate floor frequently, or at least I used to be before I was running for president. And I listen to a lot of speeches. And as you know, many of the conservative Republicans in Congress, their mantra is that they believe in small government. They believe in getting the government off the backs of the American people, which means they want to deregulate everything. So if a corporation wants to throw garbage and toxic waste into a river, hey, that's fine, that's the freedom of that corporation. They want to pollute the air, they want to give us unhealthy food, no problem. But even worse than that, you have conservative Republicans who are acting in a totally hypocritical way, who say, get the government off the backs of the American people, except when it comes to the right of a woman to control her own body. So I say to these hypocrites, if you want to get the government out of the lives of the American people, understand that it is women, not politicians, who should be able to control their own bodies. And my promise to you is I will never nominate anyone to the Supreme Court or the federal bench who is not 100% pro Roe v. Wade. We will codify, make into law, Roe v. Wade, so it's not just a Supreme Court decision. And we will expand funding significantly for Planned Parenthood. So, here we are in Claremont, New Hampshire, and in 2 days, the first primary of the election season will be held. And this primary is of enormous importance, not only unto itself, but the tone that it sets for the rest of the country. What happens in New Hampshire, in truth, is very, very important. So I am here to ask for your support in helping me win here in New Hampshire. We won in Iowa. I think if we win here in New Hampshire, we got a great chance to win in Nevada, South Carolina, and in California. We got a path to the Democratic nomination. And once we have that nomination, it will give me intense pleasure to be working with you to defeat the most dangerous president in the modern history of this country. So my request to all of you this evening is please come out to vote on Tuesday. Please bring your family members, your coworkers, your friends, your fellow students, whatever it may be. And anyone who tells you that they're too busy to come out to vote, tell them you are tired of hearing them complain about low-wage jobs, tired of hearing them complain that they don't have health care, they can't afford health care, tired of hearing them talk about their student debt, tired of them complaining about inaction on climate change. Now is not the time to sit on the sidelines. Now is the time to get involved. Please come out on Tuesday. Let's win here. Let's defeat Trump. Let's transform this country. Thank you all, Claremont.